So the Ravens take care of business at home and take care of the four-seeded Houston Texans 34-10 in advance to the AFC Championship, which I'm going to talk about the AFC Championship in the next video soon. Yes. So, yeah, the Ravens get over the hump. You love to see it, man. You love to see it. So, it was a game that very much stayed close for a bit, and then we just went away with it. We just went away with it in the second half of it. Lamar just completely took over the game. He completely took over the game in the second half. Took over. Complete takeover from Lamar Jackson in that game. So, you love to see it. But we're going to talk extensively about it. And if you're new, subscribe. And click the like button. Comment down below your thoughts. And stay tuned. I'm going to have the preview for the AFC Championship up soon. So, let's get right into it. Let's first talk about the defense. The defense played an amazing game. The defense just shut down. Just made CJ Stroud the best rookie quarterback this year look small. They just made him look small. It's nothing else. It's no other way of saying it than just that. Right? So, dude, the pass rush put pressure on CJ Stroud. What's funny is we didn't even allow a touchdown against the Texans all in both games. In both games this season. But in this game, the 10 Texans points weren't offensive touchdowns. Like, that wasn't an offensive touchdown. It was a special teams touchdown. Like, we just suffocated, especially when in the fourth quarter, when it started getting less close, and we were able to just close it out. On the pass rush, Calvin Noy and Jadeveon Clowney were consistent pressure all game long. Stroud never got comfortable at all. In terms of the secondary, we did let up a few plays. At the end of the first half, it was basically like two plays. But we've contained Nico Collins, he was one of the hottest receivers in the past 2 months. Like, he was just going off in the past 2 months. And he's actually a good receiver. He is actually a good receiver. So he's actually been good. And he's just him all by himself in the wild card round just destroyed the Browns. But Nico Collins didn't really do much this game. He had one big play at the end of the half, but that was basically it. We just shadowed him all game. And that was without our number one corner, Marlon Humphrey. Nico Collins got 68 yards. That's good. He's a really good receiver, man. So, good job by Ronald Darby and Brandon Stevens. And, yeah, the defense in general, the defense gave up 10 first downs. 10 first downs and 175 passing yards and 38 rushing yards. Like, that is the definition of suffocation. Giving up absolutely nothing against one of the better offenses in the league. This is a very good offense. Like, I think it was a top 10, top 15 offense stats-wise this year. Like, good job. If we're able to do this against the best offenses, against the best quarterbacks in the league, then we should have no problem in the AFC Championship. We really shouldn't. So, again, this defense is generational. This defense has been great. And what's funny is we did this without sacking him. We pressured him, but we didn't sack him. He was not sacked at all. Like, we just pressured Stroud all day long. But we weren't able to get a sack, an actual sack on him. So, again, we can play quarterbacks. If we play a quarterback like Mahomes, he's not bad at avoiding sacks. But even if he avoids the sack, he's not gonna be able to get anything out of the play. So, yeah. Hopefully we get a Marlon Humphrey back next week, though, however. But it's getting slim. It's getting very slim because he hasn't practiced since December 31st. Since that Dolphins game. Is he going to go and then just practice three times before the biggest game of the season? I don't know about it. I don't know about that. But, hey. Cool. But another great element is how the crowd was very involved. The crowd made a big difference in this game. Like, the Texans had 11 penalties for an equivalent of 70 yards worth of penalties. And 5-6 of them were false starts, pre-snap penalties. 5 or 6 of them were pre-snap penalties because they couldn't, they weren't able to communicate, they weren't able to do anything. And when you're not able to communicate, if the crowd gets too loud and you're not able to communicate and show signals, you have to do the silent count. And defenses pick up easily on that as well. So it's not going to work either way. So you're going to have your backs against the wall. Basically. So, yeah. Don't bet against that defense. Don't bet against that defense. Because if we're going to suffocate an offense like this, like, don't expect much against Patrick Mahomes. Don't expect us to give up much against Patrick Mahomes. Especially when we have a defensive coordinator who's actually competent. Wink was not terrible, but hey, Patrick Mahomes against Wink, he would always win. Patrick Mahomes would always destroy Wink's schemes because he was constantly blitzing, and you can't blitz against Mahomes. We're able to send 4 right now. And CJ Stroud is just lost. Or every quarterback we played. We send 4. And in result, we're leading the league in sacks. That tells you all you need to know. That tells you all you need to know about this Ravens defense. So, that's it for the defense. That's it for the defense. We're going to go to the offense. Offensively, it was bad in the first half. Well, it's specifically in the second quarter. Because in the first quarter, we were moving the ball down the field. We're moving the ball down the field. We had, again, another drive where it was unlucky. But then we had a drive at the end of the first that transitioned into the second quarter where Aguilar scored his touchdown. So that was a good drive. But after that, it was bad. After that, the offensive line could not do anything. Lamar was running for his life. Like, there was that, you know, like these moments in the game between the second quarter till the end of the second quarter. You know, like, from the drive after we scored our touchdown to basically the end of the half where the offense couldn't do anything. And in the last drive, in our last offensive drive before the first half ended, Lamar got sacked 3 times in a row. There was 3 plays in a row where sack, sack, sack. This offensive line was just unable to do anything in that second quarter. But in the third, fourth quarter, it's a whole turnaround. Night and day, exactly how you want them to play. Exactly what we want to see. Like, I have no clue what's up with this offensive line. If they have some kind of humiliation fetish or something. Because Lamar went in and lashed out at them. Yelled at them several times. Until they just started all of a sudden putting defenders on their asses. Ronnie Stanley played like all-pro Ronnie Stanley in the second half. Okay, I mean, it's not like Ronnie Stanley was playing bad in the first half. He's an all-pro tackle. But, like, he just turned from good to just God mode. Well, yeah. Other problems with the offensive line wasn't even blocking. It wasn't only blocking. We had false starts. Dumb pre-snap penalties that in crucial downs. Holding penalties in big plays. Like, in the playoffs, we cannot have shit like this, bro. When we have a big play, it cannot be negated for dumb holding call. And this is what happened. And I think that was kind of a killer in one of the drives in the second quarter. Because I think there was a big play to Zay. And then there was a holding. I don't remember who it was. I think it was Simpson. John Simpson. I don't remember. I don't remember who it was on. But after that, it was first and 10, right? It was first and 10. Zay got a play, a big play. But then because it got negated, it turned into first and 20. Instead of a first and 10 way down the field. So that did something right there. So it's good to see the offensive line in the second half play the way it's been playing in the past few weeks in comparison. So yeah, and also I think again, I'm going to transition into Todd Monken, but I really don't think anybody would have expected, nobody would have expected the Texans blitzing that much. Because D'Amico Ryan's defense did not blitz near, like, at all, almost at all in during the season. So you didn't expect that. So again, it looked very rough. I just picking up blitzes. So yeah, like they were sending the house. The Texans were sending the house the entire game. It didn't change in the second half. But what did change is the adjustments. The adjustments. So you saw the Texans blitzing, catching the offensive line off guard, right? But what we did, Todd Monken, he brought more protection. He brought Ricard in more. And what he did, he schemed shorter passes for Lamar. And then we started just going to likely 5 yards, stiff arm. Cool. You just beat them that way. Beat them that way until it doesn't until it doesn't work anymore. And what is very funny, but also disrespectful, is how we were just, some of the plays we were running in the second half, we ran many times in that second half. We just kept running the same play in the second half in our adjustments. And they couldn't stop it. That's the thing. But again, you still see the biggest difference between Todd Monken and Greg Roman is adjustments, halftime adjustments. Greg Roman, he has one game plan, and if it doesn't work, he'll stick to that game plan until it does. And most of the time, it never works. Because, like, if defenses aren't going to stop running the same shit out, until you adjust and do something else. And that's what we did. We just went in and did something else. Like, but hey, he did adjust, right? Tom Monken adjusted, but in the process, he still stuck to the run game. Because the run game was doing pretty well. He had Justice Hill. He was actually sticking in some good runs. Lamar did run way more times than he did in the season. And during the season, he didn't run. So I think it was more, again, Lamar has the keys to the offense, right? He actually has some control to the offense. I think Lamar kind of just wanted to just take it himself. He wanted to just run more. Okay, yeah, it's the playoffs. I'm doing whatever it takes, right? I did the whole pocket passer thing. It worked. It worked well. But hey, if I see a free lane, I'm going. I'm just doing that, right? So again, I think Lamar looked nervous in the first half. But hey, in the second half, flipped the switch. Completely. It was night and day. And he also got help off of that as well, right? So again, bro, it is, dude, that half, I mean, whatever speech, whatever he said in the locker room during halftime, whatever he said, it worked. Whatever he did, it worked. So, hey. And I think again, I think somebody definitely got in Lamar's ear. and just told him to just do whatever. Just told him to be Lamar. No pressure. Much more loose in the second half. And he was taking what the defense gave him. He was taking what the defense gave him. And, hey, if you needed to, use your legs. You see a lane, use your legs. Simple as that. And Todd Monken, he really has a bag, right? In the playoffs, he really has a bag, bro. And we expected it. We saw it in college. And he brought it up here. He brought it here. Like, he really caught the Texans off guard with his new play calls. And again, like, with the bootlegs, it happened twice in the second half, and both of them worked. Both of them just caught the Texans off guard. But like I said, Todd Monken stuck with the run game, which is exactly what I liked, because in the process, it wore the Texans out completely. Like, they were just out of this game in the second half. At some point, they were just out of it. So, yeah, beautiful second half. You would want to see it in the first half as well. But we basically, like, if you eliminate special teams, that's a 34-0 game. Because you had the punt return touchdown. But then the 3 points, Jordan Stout, in his first punt, it was absolutely horrible. He punted the ball. And then the Texans, they were able to get a single positive play. A single positive play, and they were already in field goal range. And then what we did, I think they went 3 and out. We forced a 3 and out. And they were still in field goal range and got to kick a field goal. Like, hey. It's basically like we haven't even given up a single point this entire game. So, hey, we have one more game. We win that next game, we're in the Super Bowl. The Ravens are going to host for the first time ever. First time ever, they're going to have an AFC Championship game at home. Also, I think they are the only franchise in the league that in all of the last 3 decades have been to an AFC Championship game. Correct me if I'm wrong. Because there's the Patriots in the 2010s. And then there's the Packers, obviously the 49ers. Actually, wait. In the 2000s, the 49ers were not good. So I heavily doubt. I heavily doubt. Hold up. Because I remember them being... Yeah, I heavily doubt they went to the AFC, into the championship games. So hold up. All right. Yeah, exactly. They didn't go in the NFC championship in the 2000s. So, the Ravens were the only franchise. Yeah, it's them. Because the Patriots went to the championship game. To many championship games, of course, in the 2000s and 2010s. But they didn't in the 2020s. The Packers didn't... Yeah, I think it's us and the Packers. Yep. Nah, I don't think they went in. Oh yeah, they did in 2010. And in 2020 as well. So yeah, it's the Ravens and the Packers. Hold up, did the Packers, I think they must have, right? Hold up. Looks like they did into in the 2000s. Looks like they didn't. So yeah, it's the Ravens. So the Patriots, they made it in the 2000s. In the 2010s, of course. But not in the 2020s. Because they've been ass in the 2020s. The Packers haven't made it in the 2000s. But have obviously made it in the 2010s. And they won a Super Bowl in the 2010s, of course. So yeah. So for the Ravens. The Ravens went in 2000. 2008. 2011. 2012. And then now 2023. So, they're only team. At least in the AFC. In the NFC, I'm going to have to go check deeper. So, let's see. And the last time Baltimore has had in a championship game, an AFC championship game, was back when the Colts existed. The Baltimore Colts existed. And that was in 1971. Or 1950s. Hold up. Yeah, it doesn't ring a bell. January 3rd, 1971. So the Ravens weren't a thing, but it was the Baltimore Colts, and they played the Raiders. And that was John Madden's Raiders, and they won, and they went on to win a championship that year as well. So that's just some facts with you. So, honestly, this team overall, I was never scared of Rust. I was never scared of Rust. Because in 2019, the Ravens didn't lose because of Rust. Right? They lost because, again, like, the defense played like shit. And the coaching was shit as well. It had nothing to do with Rust. If you bring in your A game, you're going to win. You're going to win in the divisional round against whoever. Who cares if it's the Texans? Like, some Ravens fans were really scared of the first round bye because of 2019. But, dude, that rest was worth it. Because if we played in the wild card round, Zay Flowers would not have played that game. Because Zay Flowers was still dealing with that injury. That calf injury. So he might have not even played that in the wild card round. But instead, he was able to play in the divisional round. He was able to recover from his injury. And many others as well. They deserve that rest. So, yeah. It's that simple. Also, if you want to be the top dog in the AFC, you got to have that first round bye year after year after year after year. It has to be like the Patriots where, hey, the team that's going to come to Baltimore, You're not gonna win. It's that simple. You ain't beating us, and we're just gonna be headed to the AFC Championship every year. But it's that simple. But hey, by the way, fun fact: Lamar is 1-0 in the playoffs without Greg Roman. Yeah, who would have thought? Who would have thought the problem was not Lamar and it was Greg Roman? How funny. Life comes at you fast. But hey, it's been entertaining to see all the goalposts being moved, all the gaslighting, all the excuses. But hey, we're one game away at the end of the day. So I hope you guys enjoyed. Subscribe if you're new. Click on the button. Comment down below your thoughts. And yeah. See, I'm just going to get the preview out as soon as possible. And yeah. Hopefully we have a similar conversation next week.